Susanna rubbed her swollen belly and wondered how much longer it would be before this little one decided to join them. She was 7 months pregnant. Glancing around the small kitchen, she noticed that the fire burning in the brick fireplace needed stirred, the chairs needed straightened, and her plant in the corner needed watered. "Those can wait," she told herself as she thought about how little food they had on hand at the moment and that there would still be hungry little bellies to fill at dinner. She was just thankful that they had a roof over their heads. They had been in debt for a long time, and it seemed that no matter what her husband Samuel did, they couldn't get ahead. In 1697, they had moved to Epworth, Lincolnshire, hoping to get a fresh start. But after more than 10 years there, they were still in debt. There was always another trip Samuel needed to take as the minister, another crop that had failed, and yet another mouth to feed. Susanna didn't mind being poor, but she did hate it when people criticized her husband for not providing well for the family. Yes, their house was small, their food scarce, and their possessions few, but she was content. Her happiness came from knowing God and being known by Him. She prayed that her children would know this same happiness. This baby she was carrying was number 19 for her and Samuel. Despite the fact she was weary and felt as if she'd been sick and pregnant for most of their married life, she wasn't going to take this little one for granted. Though illness, disease, and tragedy were common in those days, 9 of her 19 children were already buried, most of them as infants, and Susanna knew that each day with her remaining children was a gift. She breathed a quick prayer. "Thank you, Lord. I know that 'tis no small honor to be entrusted with the care of so many souls." The kitchen door was suddenly flung open by Susanna's daughter, Hetty. The girl paused in the doorway, breathless. Susanna was about to scold her for disturbing the peace when she noticed that the girl's eyes were filled with tears. "Why, Hetty, whatever is the matter?" she questioned. "It's Father," Hetty wailed, and her body shook with sobs. "Someone just came to say that they've taken him again." "Who's taken him?" Susanna inquired calmly as she moved to her daughter's side. Hetty flung herself into the arms of her mother. They've arrested him and said that they are taking him to jail again because of his debt," Hetty finally managed to get out. Susanna took a deep breath and quietly stroked her daughter's hair to calm her. It also gave her time to gather her own thoughts. This wasn't the first time Samuel had been arrested and taken to debtor's prison. Unless someone sent money to pay off the debt, he'd have to stay in the prison until he could work it off there. From around the corner of the hallway, she could see 3 or 4 more curious little faces sticking their heads out, watching the scene before them unfold. "Mother, are we really so poor? Can they just take Father away like that?" Hetty asked, lifting her head and sniffing. "Yes, Hetty, we are, and yes, they can," Susanna answered honestly. This brought more tears. "Oh, why does this have to happen to us? What are we ever going to do? And Mother, what have we done to deserve this? Why does God allow such things to happen?" Hetty couldn't stop the questions from flowing. Susanna gently held Hetty at arm's length so she could look in her face. "Listen, Hetty, as long as we have God, it doesn't really matter what's going on or where we are. God is enough. You must trust in His love and goodness. Now, dry your tears. We shall have no more of those. There is nothing we can do for the time being but to wait and hear from your Father." Suddenly, feeling the strong need to pray, Susanna sent Hetty on her way before throwing her apron over her head and sinking onto a stool. Her children knew that they were not to disturb her whenever the apron was over her head, so she could be guaranteed some quiet for the time being. Despite what she had said to Hetty, she could feel the discouragement and fear in her own heart. Many years on her knees had brought her to the realization that prayer was her greatest weapon during such battles. As a child, she'd made a commitment that for every hour she spent in entertainment, she would spend 1 hour with God in prayer and in the Word. Now, as an adult, she found this was impossible. Instead, she decided to spend 2 hours a day in prayer. In her mind, this was time well spent. So often she found herself needing wisdom or peace. "Oh God," her heart moaned, "I know that you are here. Help me to endure this well. You know how much harder it is for me to feed the family when this happens. Help my children's faith in you to be strengthened through this trial as we see you provide once more. Lord, I am content to fill a little space if you are glorified." An hour later, Susanna rose from the stool feeling much refreshed. God was able. He would carry them through. And carry them he did. After a few weeks in prison, Samuel was released due to various people's sending money on his behalf. However, their troubles were far from over. One night, after everyone had long been asleep, Susanna's eyes flew open and she bolted upright in bed. What had awakened her? She could hear Hetty's voice calling out loudly and urgently. She took a brief moment to gather her bearings, then she smelled it. Smoke. Something was burning. She stumbled out of bed, her mind racing as she thought of the children. Samuel had already beaten her to the door. Throwing it open, they saw thick smoke and flames licking at the roof. "There's no time to gather anything," Samuel cried urgently. "We must get out now." Susanna rushed into the hall, calling for their maid, Betty, to gather the children from the nursery. Being 8 months pregnant, Susanna knew she would be of little help to the maid and that it was urgent for her to get out of the smoke. Rushing downstairs, Susanna tried to make it out the front door, but the wind was so strong that it blew the flames directly toward her. The heat was so intense. 3 times Susanna tried to break through the flames, but was driven back. Finally, on the 4th attempt, she gathered her skirts tightly around herself and forged ahead. She could feel the heat scorching her legs and face, but she pushed on. Suddenly, she felt the heat subsiding and the cool night air hitting her face. She'd made it. Susanna gazed wildly about, searching for Samuel and the children. No one. The yard was empty. She hurried around the side of the house, frantically scanning the garden. Relief flooded her heart as she saw several of her children standing a safe distance from the house. "Where's your father?" she asked as she gathered some of her littlest children into her arms. Patty, the second youngest, pointed to the house just as Samuel emerged, coughing and sputtering. "It's no use," he said, gasping for air. "John is still in the nursery. I could hear him crying, but there's no way for me to get to him." Susanna felt like her heart was tearing in two as she thought about her little John left in the fire. By this time, several men from the town had gathered to help. Suddenly, they heard a voice calling from the upstairs window. Looking up, they could see John's little face peering out at them. Somehow, he had managed to crawl up and break out the window. One of the men shouted, "Quickly, let's see if we can make it up to him from the outside." There was no time to fetch a ladder, so one man was hoisted up on the shoulders of another. He pulled John into his arms just as there was a loud splintering sound. Suddenly, the roof crashed into the nursery. The place where John had been only seconds before was engulfed in flames. Susanna sank to the ground as she gathered John into her arms. "Thank you, God," she cried aloud as tears streamed down her face. "You've saved him, just like a brand plucked from the fire." She didn't know for what purpose God had allowed John's life to be spared, but in her heart, she made a vow to particularly care for this little soul. "Lord, help me to teach him true religion and the way that he should live so that his life can bring you honor. And Lord, please give me the grace I'm going to need to do it carefully and sincerely." Moments later, the whole Wesley family huddled together, watching their home go up in flames.